very fond of us. Welcome back. Those of you who've been away, those of you who are here, and guess what? I am back. My gratitude to Pastor Marin, who covered Sunday after Easter, to Jim Baker Jr., who covered last Sunday when I was away, and who is now a recent graduate of Lancaster Theological Seminary as of yesterday, and going to be studying ordination and heading toward a call to ministry. So we're going to have a wonderful time today. We are scheduled in worship to have a children's moment in Sunday school. Not seeing children here, we will not have that today. But you are here, and as one child I overheard saying, as they turned to their parents, well, you're a child of God, aren't you? So, theology from little ones, age 5 and under, is amazing. So welcome to worship today. Join with me on the call to worship. The risen Christ declares, peace be with you.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we do not doubt, Father, in you.
While most of the world has already forgotten Easter, we know that every Sunday is a mini Easter year-round.
On this 32nd day, we continue to celebrate the day as also a season of 50 days.
Alleluia, Christ is risen, we continue to say.
We say it because we believe its power, convicted of its meaning for us in the world who long to be of God.
Let us worship God.
Thank you.
all these things, we trust you to give us what we need. With you, we are safe and secure. Comforted, we will be ready, believing what we need to believe. Going where you want us to go. Living as you want us to live. Serving as you need us to serve. And giving as you have blessed us to give. Amen.
So, dear friends, in confidence, let us receive the abundant help of our God, trusting that all manner of things shall be well, and all manner of things well. Let us, as faithful disciples of all generations, pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not let us fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Dear friends, the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace. And indeed it is good to see you. See that I would have spoken to the children about roll call. And for those of you who may not know it, when the children come for Sunday school, they get these around their neck with their name to remind them that they are on the roll, that they are on the list, that they are a part of Sunday school in the church. And so there's a picture on this lanyard of the bell tower here at the congregation. There are smiling faces, and simply says, Leacock Presbyterian Sunday School. This helps them to know who they are and what they are a part of. Now, unlike the old days when teachers in school, say for Sunday school, kept attendance books, they were called roll books. And your name was on the list. And if you showed up, what did you get beside your name? A star, or a check mark, or something to tell you your record of presence, your being on the roll. But whether you show up or not, you're still on the roll, okay? We're going to be talking about that today after hearing the scripture. So you did sort of end up being the children, right? Okay, that's all good. Unlike what is listed in the bulletin, instead of reading from Acts 4, I'm going to be reading from Acts chapter 2. Acts 2, verses 42 through 47, and then I'm actually changing up the other reading as well. Instead of 1 John, I'm going to be reading from 1 Peter. So, got to keep everybody on their toes, including myself. So I want you to think about, before I read from Acts 2, chapter 2 tells us that this is early on in the life of the church. These new believers who were old believers, these are Jewish Christians. And they're juggling a lot in this new world, this post-resurrection world, trying to figure out who they are and what list they're on. Listen. They, as they gathered, devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. We need to notice what this does not say. It does not say, following the resurrection, they continued going to the synagogue and listened to the local rabbi. Read from the sacred scrolls and preach from that word. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship and the breaking of bread. So in one sentence, they're on a new list, a new role of being asked to listen to new teaching, gather for fellowship, and around the table. Just like as Jesus did at the Last Supper. The breaking of bread, and one more thing, and prayer. Gathering for teaching, fellowship, communion, all in one sentence. They were all struck with awe. It came upon everyone because there were many signs and wonders being done by the apostles. These apostles are not rabbis. They are not teachers, as Jesus was. But Jesus gave them a mantle. They are now the We are the teachers. We are the leaders. We who learn and embrace Holy Word, Holy Scripture, can and must become those who share what we know. All who believed were together, and they had all in common. I don't know about you, but I have trouble picturing what that would have looked like. They had everything in common. Did they sell their houses? Did they all move in together? Did they form a commune? What does it mean that they had all things in common? Does that mean every meal was a potluck? You know, they came from their individual homes and just you to wonder, it certainly causes me to wonder what this early community post-resurrection was like. And then the next verse goes on to explain further what it means that they had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all. So if you sell or give away what you have, how are you going to get what you need? It's a little hard to think about how practical this might have been, could have been, would have been. As any of them had need, they did this. So would that mean we all come to church and bring our closets of clothes with us and I show you what I've got that doesn't fit anymore or you might like and, oh Jim, I'll take that shirt or I like that tie. You can have one of my 100 ties, yes you may. But you're not going to get my vintage ties from the 1960s that are pure silk. I'm not going to hang on to those. What does this mean? This radical new early community trying to figure out post-resurrection what it means to be followers of Jesus. Now this is the next interesting verse. They did all these things, fellowship, sharing in common, meeting for prayer, Lord's Supper, teaching. How often did they do it? Next verse, day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple. Now we find out where they're gathering. These are good, faithful Jews. They're going to the temple. They're going to their synagogues. Day by day, does that mean every day? Didn't they work? Did they stop their jobs? Who did the ironing and the cooking and the shopping? Makes us wonder. Day by day, much time spent together in the temple, and they broke bread. Not at the temple. They broke bread at home. So this is now a worshiping community that's juggling what it means to be a faithful Jew. You go to the temple, you go to the synagogue, but we're going to do some good spiritual things at home. And so they broke bread at home. And they ate their food with glad and generous hearts. Do you know that the early celebrations of Holy Communion repeated the Passover experience? And it wasn't just gathering around a bit of bread and a small cup of juice. Communion meant having a meal together, and then a part of that meal. Actually, I kind of like that idea. So every time we have communion, let's have a potluck. Isn't that a great idea? How about every Sunday? I like that idea. Let's just have a potluck every Sunday. Praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. Interesting word. Those who were being convinced, those who were being compelled, those who were being arm-twisted into this new world, post-resurrection, no, those who were being saved. And I'm sure some of them were asking, well, aren't we already saved? We are God's people. We were saved long ago. But now, they're being saved again. Say this with me. I am saved.
I am saved.
I was saved.
I was saved.
I am being saved.
I am being saved.
I shall be saved.
I shall be saved.
Amen. If you take nothing else with you today, it's a process. It's a journey. It's not once and done and over where you can name the day and the hour and the minute. It's God at work, the Holy Spirit at work, and you and me in the resurrection community, getting us on the journey to where we need to be, toward fellowship, sharing concerns one with another, communing praying, teaching, learning still. That's what it means to be post-resurrection people. Here is the first reading and a little mini sermon. This might go short today, because we are going to have a potluck afterward, right? No, not today, okay. I'll come back next Sunday. 1 Peter, now reading from 1 Peter, chapter 2. As newborn infants long for pure spiritual milk, so that by it we may grow into salvation, that's the idea of salvation again, if indeed you have tasted, what a wonderful image, that the Lord is good. Tasting of fellowship, tasting of the Lord's Supper, tasting of in prayer, and tasting of holy scripture, spiritual food. Indeed, we have tasted and seen that the Lord is good. Come to him, the one who is a living stone, the rejected by mortals, yet chosen, precious in God's sight. And you yourselves, living like stones, let yourselves be built up into a spiritual house. You're a stone, you're a stone, you're a stone, I'm a stone, we're all stones. We're all part of this foundation that is the resurrected Christ, and we're being built up person by person, stone by stone, to be the living, spiritual house of God, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through the risen one, Jesus the Christ. Here ends the reading of Holy Scripture for today. Well, you are familiar with roll calls. You've experienced it growing up in elementary school and beyond, Sunday school, as I've already mentioned. Maybe those of you who are here today are members of various organizations. You're on that role. It might be a community group, might be a club, or an organization. If you've gone to college or a technical school and you're an alumni, you're on that list. We are on many lists. We are on many roles. And we're on another role. We are citizens of the United States of America. We're on the citizenship list. We are counted. We're in the population numbers, but our name is known, and we've got a lot of numbers with our names, do we not? Social Security, for one. We're on lots of lists. We're on lots of roles, and that tells us how we belong and how we are connected and how we not only get what we need, but how we're able to give what we can and that others need. In Acts, the address was to these early believers. These early disciples, these early apostles who had become very timid, who had fallen asleep, when Jesus invited them in the garden to pray, and he kept nudging them, and they kept falling asleep again, and he was alone, alone, alone. And alone the next day in judgment and trial and crucifixion, until there were some brave enough to show up, his mother, a beloved disciple, Peter. And those who lost their courage, who even denied Jesus. I don't know him. I don't know him. I never knew him. Well, weren't you one of them? Peter had the chance to redeem himself that day on the beach, which is actually kind of the picture in the bulletin. Jesus on the beach, one of the last appearances. Look in your bulletin under the heading. That's Jesus on the beach with the apostles who didn't know yet what to do, and they went back to fishing. But they did know what to do at that point. Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Jesus gave him the chance to redeem himself. Every time he had denied Jesus, he had the chance to redeem himself. And then Jesus gave a command, an instruction, a charge. Then feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. Teach, gather, pray, commune, be in fellowship with one another. Continue the program I started. Now, there are some characteristics in Acts 2 that I did not, some verses I did not read that I'm going to tell you about. So all these things I've mentioned are actions, they're behaviors. You have gathered, you have come here, you got up, you got dressed, hope you had a good breakfast, had whatever you need, came here, drove here, you gathered. That's an action. We have sung, we've heard handbells, hands have rung these bells, and fingers have moved over the keys, and you've been greeted, and the heat is on, and lights are on. Things have been done. Those are actions. But the book of Acts goes on to describe not only the things we're to do, but the way we are to be, the behaviors, the characteristics. One of them, be holy, H-O-L-Y. Be pure. Be joyful. Be thankful. And always found praising. How good are we at those things? I don't know how holy I am. I'm probably a pretty immature pastor now that I think about it. I was once told by someone in another church, where Jim, you always get what you want. I'm thinking, that's not the way we live life in the Presbyterian Church. We vote on things. We do things by consensus. I don't always get what I want. To be pure and holy, joyful. Why does the scripture add always? Why did it have to do that? To be always thankful. To be always praising. Can I tell you a little personal story? I was, this past week, I've been in Virginia, Thursday, a week ago, to late this week. My brother John and I are mowing. We have a contractor that mows our mother's yard, but we do it when we're there. So pull out the riding mower. I'm on the riding mower. I've mowed a ton of times. A ton of times. As I come along, the front tire hits a piece of cinder block against the one farmhouse. Raises up the mower off the ground. I drive off of the cinder block, and the deck of the mower pounds down on top of a metal plate where there used to be some LP gas tanks. And the blade, two blades, the one blade crashes down from the impact into the metal plate. And of course, the riding mower starts jarring and moving. I'm like, what did I do? I had this thing set on 5 inches above the ground, and this metal plate is smacked at flat on the ground. The belt was thrown off, the one blade was bent, and a whole big pulley assembly made out of aluminum cracked in 4 places where it was bolted onto the frame. It's like I was so humiliated and embarrassed. And that's because the day before that, I bent another blade on a culvert. And my brother's a repair technician. It's like, oh, just let me do the mowing. Just let me do the mowing. All this damage. So we get the mower up on ramps. We have to disassemble everything. John's going to order the parts in Nashville. Said, I will pay for it. He said, no, let's just take it out of the farm account. You're on the list. You're on the Dear government, I was not joyful, I was not thankful, I was not grateful. I was not a happy camper. I was not very paranoid. However, I did not say any bad words. I did not. What I did was I started praying to God, and my prayer was, God, help me. God, help me, because there's something I'm not getting right here. First Peter goes on to say, not only are those the things we're supposed to put on as clothing, be holy, pure, joyful, thankful, praising, we're supposed to do all the actions, devote ourselves to teaching, gather together for fellowship, meet in the breaking of bread, engage in prayer and service, and show others what God has done, and share your possession. That's a long list of things we as believers are supposed to do. We don't get off easy, do we? We cannot live to ourselves if we are part of the gathered community. First Peter goes on to say, well, that if you put on those things, it's kind of like New Year's resolutions. I prefer not to make a list for New Year's resolutions. I prefer to add things to my life, and then some of the other stuff will be pushed on the back burner and I won't do it anymore. So if you're not reading enough and you say my resolution for the New Year is to read more, watch less TV, then if you're reading more, you don't have time to watch TV. You're not going to do it. It's a trade-off. But to add on to life, we have to get rid of some stuff. And First Peter goes on to say that we must rid ourselves of malice. These are big words. I don't even know what some of these mean. We are to rid ourselves of malice, guile, insincerity, dishonesty, jealousy, envy, not talking about others behind their back, or just pretending to be good. We are to grow into our salvation by getting rid of some stuff, by putting on some stuff, and by doing all those four, five, six things. Gathering, sharing, meeting, teaching, engaging, all of that. When the roll is called down here, I wonder if we will be able, if we're not on this roll, when the roll is called up yonder. That old gospel hymn, we're going to hear it later today. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. If we're not on the roll down here, those early disciples, those early Jews, trying to sort through all the particulars, what do we do, when do we do it, how do we do it, to be faithful to our risen Christ, our friend, our beloved rabbi. Do we still go to synagogue? Those were their questions. Do we still worship on the Sabbath, sundown Friday to sundown Sunday? By the way, the early Jews started worshiping on the Lord's Day, Sunday, to commemorate the resurrection day. And the early Jews, I read up on them because I was curious myself, the early Jews did continue going to temple and synagogue. Some believed in the risen Christ, some didn't. There were like two groups, like you all here. One side over here believed in the risen Christ, this side didn't, but they all wanted to be faithful Jews. They did that for a good while, until finally the real Jews pushed the new Jews out. It took a good while before that happened. It's like, we can't tolerate all this risen Jesus Christ stuff and blah, blah, blah. It even maybe, I think, took into the 300s until synagogue life really split off. Things became so controversial and so anxiety-producing that they split, and we know that's the story of the church down through the centuries. We split and we split and we split. We don't get along. We form new churches. We have our own little brand of theology, you know, and that's true along Route 30. This church, that church, us, them, we, them, all of us. Do not let it be lost on us that if we do these biblical things laid out, we are then on the roll. And the roll is called down here, let us show up, let us show up and be faithful, so that when the wall of oil is called up yonder, we will be there. Amen. Let us sing again. Many pearl, I'm just so glad to be here. She's always coming up with something. doesn't have a mini pro hat. Do you have a mini pro hat? Or different hats?
Yeah.
Yeah, lots of hats. Mother never has white hats. Okay. You will see the Bolton joint session trustee meeting is coming Thursday. My schedule is really tight on Thursday. I may have to zoom in. I'd like to talk with leaders after that. So, Dave, maybe you... Yes, I'll do that. Oh, yeah. I'm kind of jumping in there. But, yes, thank you. Lovely to be talking to you. But anyway, you'll see these things in the bulletin. Let me finish. Prayer family this week, Chad. And yes, thank you. You're children, right? Yes, thank you. Nina or Nina?
Nina.
Nina, okay. Beautiful flowers in the sanctuary. Yes, so... For your gifts and tithes and offerings, which lift up this ministry, extend it, continue it, join with me in our prayer of thanksgiving for this day. God and children, as Jesus gathered on the beach that day, as he witnessed the disciples attempting to fish, remove our doubts of an abundant catch. Show us where it has been. Take away concern that cripples. Keep us strong in our giving and in our living. Help us hear again the words of your peace, recognizing your presence in our ordinary daily world. Receive our offerings as a sign of our commitment to your life-giving ways. We entrust to you our hearts, our energies, and our lives. Amen. It is indeed today that we lift up with prayers of concern, Jean Standard. Fell from her hip, did have hip surgery. I got to smoke with her following the surgery. She was propped up in her bed with her daughter Susan there. She covered your prayers for recovery and good healing, and she was enjoying a salmon burger. It sounded pretty good to me. So, but isn't it the way after surgery you're still in pain meds, and it's maybe like day two or three that you start suffering something on that order? She was in very good spirits. She was high on drugs. Imagine. She's got a lifestyle baby. She's what else do you have to announce or to share? Anything? Yes.
Our son is like oldest boy, CJ, just turned two, so we had a party yesterday at their house, and that was fun. And their youngest one is Stetson, and he will be 8 months at the end of this.
Wow. The growing family. They're busy parents. Do you pray for our children who are not here today? Some are traveling in advance. Several, Camila and Val, are sick, could not be here today. They wanted to be here. You don't want to show up and have a fever and feel lousy. All that. Anything else, Angela?
We do. Well, as you may know, this was our last bell choir performance, and actually some of our members couldn't even make it, and one had to leave actually to go to urgent care. So it's unfortunate that we are not all here, but we do have, we do want to thank our bell choir director, because she has been our rock and our strength. She works tirelessly behind the scenes. You know, we barely, we show up and we practice and we play, but our choir director, bell choir director, is behind the scenes doing all the finding the music for our numbers, which are low, and our skill level, which is also low. Not I'm speaking for myself and some of our newbies. The newbies have, we struggle and we appreciate our elders that have been here. So we wanted to give her.
You know who we're talking about, don't you?
Thank you so much. So we just wanted to say thank you to our bell choir director. I have a little poem prepared, but I'll spare you that actually. And so we just wanted to say thank you to Karen.
Thank you.
A poem
for now.
Thank you.
Once a music leader, always a music leader. Anything else? Thank you all for that affirmation in the year. Yes, it adds greatly to worship. Yes, indeed. So come back as you can. Anything else? Anything else? We're all good. Are there refreshments today? In the narthex? Yeah, okay, good. I'll show up. Great. Anything else? You all are so gracious and kind. You do need to know, I want you to know, that your Pastor Monument Committee, PNC, has worked regularly, faithfully. A mission information form has been given to the Committee of Presbytery that needs to have their eyes on it. They have it. It's in hand. They're going to look at it over in May, May 18th or somewhere in there. We do have an upcoming Presbytery meeting on May 23rd. It is in person at Oxford. This coming Sunday, May 14th already, it's hard to believe May is here, is Mother's Day, Festival of the Christian Home. I'll be speaking to that. The next Sunday, May 21st, we're going to celebrate Pentecost early with Holy Communion on May 21st. That's because on May 28th, I have the nerve to leave you again. Sorry, take another vacation Sunday. For an important family gathering again back in Virginia. After that, they're going to be coming to me, and I'm not going to be the one traveling. And so indeed, in mid-June, all my children are flying in from Portland, Albuquerque, Houston, to gather in Lancaster and in Maryland for a week to celebrate Emily. You've met Emily on her 30th birthday, which is July 30th, but hey, why not start early? So these next 6 weeks or so are going to be big in my family, and but you're my family also. You really are. I do miss you when I'm away. I really mean that. I really, truly mean that. I will continue in Zoom fellowship even when I'm away. Wherever I am around this globe, I will do my best to join in. And I'll watch it when I'm driving and doing that too. But I do have a clip on my dish. I can put my phone up there. Just saying. And I also have voice recognition. Try to be safe. Go well. Anything else? Or I'll move us on. Prayers of the people. Let us pray. Our God, we bring our silences. We bring our words. We declare that you are a mighty God because of the power of not only redemption, but the power of resurrection. That the witness of this season stands among us, stands in our hearts, is placed upon our minds. And so may the continuing message of the resurrection hover over the shadows of our time, and where the sun is not shining bright, and where there's disenfranchisement and marginalization and poverty and violence, and wickedness and concern, and the overwhelming affairs of this life that keep people oppressed. May redemption and resurrection also be a day of freedom. May that gift, may the power of that spread from us to others and around the world. May it not stop because you will not stop, we will not stop. As we move through every sorrow and trial of this life, uphold us with knowledge of the final morning when the world will be called up yonder in the glorious presence of your risen Son, where we will share in his resurrection, which will be our resurrection, redeemed and restored to the fullness of life and forever freed to be your people. That is our prayer today. Amen. I know that my Redeemer lives. disciples in this age, send us forth. We offer our prayers, as we've already done, on behalf of the entire universe in which we are privileged to live. As we go out from this place among neighbors, family, and friends, and co-workers, in our communities, in our needful and hurting world, may we be the neighbors that will be willing to share and to love. Continue to transform us. Heal all that is broken as we go forward.